Hi there. So in this episode, we take a look at preparing hydrogen peroxide from scratch. Let's first talk about peroxides in general. As you might know, peroxides are compounds in which two oxygen atoms are connected via a single bond. Here is the MO diagram for peroxide. There are 8 electrons in bonding orbitals and 6 electrons in antibonding orbitals, which makes up to a bond order of 1. There are inorganic as well as organic peroxides. So this is the hydrogen peroxide molecule. As you can see, there's the peroxide group right in the middle, with 2 hydrogen atoms attached to each oxygen molecule. The special thing about the peroxide group is that the bond length between the oxygen atoms is fairly large, resulting in a weak bond. That's why hydrogen peroxide is easily decomposed into oxygen and water and why it is such a strong oxidizing agent. We can look at hydrogen peroxide as a weak acid. If we deprotonate it, we'll form the peroxide ion. This ion is fairly stable and can form salts with a lot of metal cations. Sodium peroxide and barium peroxide being just 2 examples. These inorganic peroxides can be formed by reaction with hydrogen peroxide or by reacting oxides with air. When these inorganic peroxides are protonated by water or acid, hydrogen peroxide is formed. Okay, so let's sum up. In order to prepare hydrogen peroxide, we need to prepare an inorganic peroxide first. We can then react this inorganic peroxide with water or acid and hydrogen peroxide will be formed. Here, we will present 2 methods. The first one is with barium peroxide, the second one with sodium peroxide. Let's get started. First of all, we prepare some barium peroxide. For this, we need barium oxide, that will react with oxygen to form barium peroxide. A convenient route to barium oxide is by decomposition of barium nitrate via thermolysis. So here is some barium nitrate. Check out our Christmas special video, if you want to see how you can make this yourself. It is a white, fluffy, slightly lumpy solid. Weigh out about 20 grams of this inside a porcelain crucible. The exact amount is not critical. Tamp down the barium nitrate inside the crucible to allow for good heat transfer. Switch off the lights to see the flame of the Bunsen burner better. We have to adjust the height of the bottom of the crucible, so that it is in the hottest part of the flame. That's why we like to use a ring stand rather than a tripod. When everything is ready and set up, place a lid on the crucible and start heating it. Our target temperature is about 600 degrees C. The exact temperature is not important. It's fine as long as you can get the crucible to a faint red glow. Since this reaction can't be overdone, you can blast the crucible with full power. After a few minutes, the barium nitrate starts to melt and sink down at the walls of the crucible. Another 10 minutes into the reaction and all the barium nitrate is molten and decomposing, as indicated by the effervescence. After about 45 minutes, most of the barium nitrate has decomposed, so we removed the heat source. Here is our barium oxide. It's a lumpy, slightly greenish solid. We now set up a gas washing bottle filled with sodium hydroxide, a drying tube and quartz tube filled with our barium oxide. Carbon dioxide from the air will be removed by the sodium hydroxide, and the oxygen from the dry air will react with the barium oxide to form barium peroxide. Start the flow of air and gently heat the barium oxide. Don't heat too much, as barium peroxide will decompose at high temperatures, forming barium oxide and oxygen again. The reaction is complete after a few minutes, and the barium peroxide was allowed to cool in a stream of air. After grinding, this is how our barium peroxide looks like. A slightly yellow, lumpy solid. For the second way to prepare barium peroxide, we first need to make some barium hydroxide. For this, just add a solution of sodium hydroxide to any soluble barium salt. We are using barium chloride here. It's slightly cloudy, but that's okay. Immediately, a white precipitate of barium hydroxide octahydrate is formed. We filtered to obtain solid barium hydroxide and a saturated solution of barium hydroxide as the filtrate. We then measured out about 60 milliliters of 3% hydrogen peroxide solution. This was then added to the saturated barium hydroxide solution. a thick white precipitate of barium peroxide is formed. This was separated by filtration just as before. The barium peroxide can be dehydrated and dried on a hot plate on a low setting. So you might ask, what's the sense of preparing barium peroxide from hydrogen peroxide and then convert it back to hydrogen peroxide? The answer is simple. Any concentration of hydrogen peroxide can be used to precipitate barium peroxide. This can then be used to prepare a much more concentrated solution of hydrogen peroxide. For example, you could start with a 1% solution of hydrogen peroxide and prepare a 40% solution of hydrogen peroxide without conducting a vacuum distillation. Here is a comparison of the barium peroxide prepared with hydrogen peroxide on the left and with air on the right. In order to convert this to hydrogen peroxide, we add some concentrated sulfuric acid to a few ice cubes inside the beaker. The more concentrated you want your hydrogen peroxide to be, the more concentrated sulfuric acid you have to use. It is very important to keep the mixture cool to avoid decomposition of the hydrogen peroxide. We then add barium peroxide until most of the sulfuric acid is neutralized. Note how a thick white precipitate of barium sulfate is formed. This slurry was then filtered via gravity filtration. To test it, we prepared two test tubes. The left one is filled with potassium permanganate, the right one with potassium iodide. When hydrogen peroxide is added, the potassium permanganate will be reduced to manganese dioxide, which catalytically decomposes hydrogen peroxide into oxygen and water. With the iodide, elemental iodine is formed. This is our yield after filtering and washing the barium sulfate in the filter with some distilled water. As you might be able to tell, the second method to prepare hydrogen peroxide will be a lot funnier, as it comprises burning elemental sodium in air. Set up a crucible and have a lid ready, just in case the reaction gets too vigorous. It is also a good idea to remove everything from the hood that is flammable or sensitive towards heat. Thank you. We simply take an arbitrary amount of sodium, clean the oil from the surface. This piece is then cut into smaller chunks and put inside the crucible. To ignite it, we simply have to heat the crucible. The sodium will first melt and finally catch on fire. Enjoy!
Thank you.
What happens here is that when sodium burns in air, not only sodium oxide is formed, but also a significant quantity of sodium peroxide. The latter is so reactive that hydrogen peroxide is formed when it is added to water. Once the reaction is over, put a lid on the crucible and allow it to cool down completely. This is how the sodium peroxide mixed with sodium oxide looks like. The heat was so intense that it cracked the crucible. This converts easily to hydrogen peroxide. Simply add water and some ice cubes to a beaker with strong magnetic stirring. Sodium peroxide is then added slowly, until the desired concentration of hydrogen peroxide is obtained. Make sure that the temperature stays as low as possible to avoid decomposition. Note how the solution is strongly alkaline. The hydrogen peroxide is then tested as before. As you can imagine, sodium peroxide is an extremely strong oxidizer. Since only them player is allowed to test oxidizing agents with red phosphorus, we have to revert back to some lamb-grade cereals. These are mixed with the sodium peroxide and a few drops of water are added. Thanks for watching and stay tuned. We are going to clean up this mess now.